وبعد فاعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم. فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي سيدنا محمد وشر الأمور محدثات وكل محدثات بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. Brothers, many a time when someone, a youngster, starts to practice the deen, he comes to the masajid, any masajid where he places his trust and starts to pray. But then he's approached by individuals who ask him regarding his religion. And because many youth in our society today do not have rasakh, meaning to be firm in their knowledge, they get confused over a number of topics. From amongst them topics is the topic of bid'ah, innovation in the religion. Other topics included where someone may come to them and ask them, Ain Allah, where is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Or they may be asked, do you believe Allah is on the throne above the seven heavens? Or regarding the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, regarding his knowledge. From amongst them topics like I've just mentioned is innovation. So they are told that anything new in the religion, which however it may be, even if it looks good or if it looks evil, is a bid'ah al-balala, an innovation of misguidance. Hence, such people, they make mawlid haram, or the mawlid of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam haram, to follow a madhab haram. And they quote the hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّ خَيْرَ الْحَدِيثِ كِتَابُ اللَّهِ, that verily the best of narratives is the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَخَيْرُ الْهَدِيِ, or you can read as وَخَيْرُ الْهَدِيِ, the best of guidance. هَدْيُ سَيِّدِنَا مُحَمَّدٍ. In the hadith, the word Sayyidina is not in there, but the wording of the hadith is هَدْيُ مُحَمَّدٍ, is the guidance of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَالشَّرُّ الْأُمُورِ مُحْدَثَاتٍ, and the worst of matters are the newly invented matters. مُحْدَثَاتٍ, from أَحْدَثَ يُحْدِثُ إِحْدَاثًا. وَكُلُّ مُحْدَثَةٍ بِدْعَةٍ, and all newly invented matters are an innovation. وَكُلُّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ, and all bid'ah innovation is misguided. The second part, and every innovation is misguided, has only been reported by Ibn Majah in his Sunan, and according to some scholars is a weak addition to his hadith. So we have brothers approaching, young brothers, people who just begin to pray with this hadith that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, كُلُّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ, that every innovation is misguidance. Hence they say from this hadith that anything new, even if it corresponds with the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is misguidance. So they place in this the mawlid of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the following of the mazahib and other matters, ila ghayri dhalik. However, when they are given evidence from the book and the sunnah showing that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam disliked bad innovations in the religion, they respond by saying, كُلُّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ. What does the word كُلُّ mean? The word كُلُّ means every. Hence they reply that here the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stated every innovation in the religion is misguided. In the language of the Arabs, they say the word كُلُّ means every. Hence every innovation is misguided. We respond to that by saying, firstly, the word كُلُّ does come in the Arabic language in various parts of the Quran and in the hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where the term كُلُّ is used. However, there is exception in certain places. For instance, hadith narrated by Imam al-Nasa'i
إمام الترمذي من السنن، إمام أبو داود، الإمام أحمد من المسند، وابن نفسنا الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: كل عين زانية. Every عين eye, every eye is a fornicator. And we ask the question here, the word kullu has come. Every eye is a fornicator. And we ask, are the eyes of the messenger عليهم الصلاة والسلام fornicators? No, نعوذ بالله من ذلك. There are many Muslims, many people from the Muslim Ummah who fall into this كل عين زانية. However, their eyes have never fornicated in their lives. This shows that the word kullu does not always come encompassing every single matter. Sometimes it comes with an exception. So we may ask as to when does this exception come and when did you gain your exception? You are making an exception for the term bid'ah. Where do you get this exception from? We say we get this exception from him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who has been sent with the Kitab of Allah and with his Sunnah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah ta'ala said, لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ, that you may explain to them what has been revealed upon you in order that they may think. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam further elucidates his Sunnah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and explains what he meant sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by his qawl, كل بدعة ضلالة. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has been reported to say hadith narrated by Imam al-Tirmidhi in his Sunan, where he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من سن في الإسلام سنة حسنة فله أجر من عمل بها فله أجرها وأجر من عمل بها ومن سن في الإسلام سنة سيئة فله وزرها ووزر من عمل بها إلى يوم القيامة. This hadith story has been narrated by Imam al-Nasa'i in his Sunan and Imam Muslim in his Sahih. What this means is that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has stated for us that whosoever practices a practice that is a good practice, for him is the reward of who, for him is the reward, and for whosoever practices upon the Sunnah, he also attains that reward. And whosoever instates a bad practice in al-Islam, من سن في الإسلام سنة سيئة فله وزرها, he gains its wisdom, its bad deed, ووزر من عمل بها إلى يوم القيامة. And the bad deed of those who practice upon this bad practice up until the Day of Judgment. This is a sahih hadith of the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In another hadith narrated by Imam al-Tirmidhi in his Sunan, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من ابتدع بدعة ضلالة لا ترضي الله ورسوله فله مثل آثام من عمل بها. That whosoever incorporates a bad bid'ah, here the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has used the term bid'atan dalalatan, a bad bid'ah, فَلَهُ مِثْلُ آثَامِ مَنْ عَمِلَ بِهَا, for him is the life of the sins of those who practice upon this bad bid'ah. And he mentioned sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the middle of a hadith, لَا يُرْضِي اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ, this type of bid'ah that does not mislead Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hence, when we understand the term bid'ah in al-Islam, we understand from these ahadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that this means those bid'ah that go against the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And any new practice which is incorporated into Islam, which goes against an upward in the Quran or the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then such a bid'ah is rejected. If it goes against the Kitab of Allah wa Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hence the hadith, كل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار, is a hadith عام خص عنه البعض أي general حديث and there are some specifics that are related to this hadith and those specifics relate to the fact that when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stated generally that all bid'ah is misguidance, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then excluded those practices which are practiced within al-Islam and are in accordance with the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and do not contradict the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, those practices are acceptable. Some people may reject the hadith من سنة في الإسلام سنة حسنة and they reinterpret this hadith. They reinterpret this hadith to refer to a specific event where the sadaqat were being collected. The charity was being collected by the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked for the sadaqat. And people did not present the sadaqat until a sahabi radiallahu anhu stood and presented the sadaqat. After he had presented them, people stood and one after the other, they started to present the sadaqat to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hence he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من سنة في الإسلام سنة حسنة إلى آخر الحديث. They say that the أسباب الورود, the reason for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying this is specific to that event. Hence, whosoever incorporates a practice in al-Islam, this was said regarding a specific event where the sadaqat were given. They also answer by saying that if they practice in al-Islam a practice that has a root in the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then that practice is not rejected and is accepted. With regard to the first, we would say that if we were to accept the argument that the reasons for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are taken into account as to why he said that, then we would reject many ahadith. For instance, the famous hadith, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى إِلَى آخِرِ الْحَدِيثِ فَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ فهجرته إلى الله ورسوله ومن كانت هجرته للدنيا يصيبها أو امرأة ينكحها فهجرته إلى ما هاجر إليه أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم. This hadith was said regarding the actual event of the hijrah of the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم. And it was said regarding people who made immigration from Mecca to المدينة المنورة just for marriage. So the Messenger of Allah said, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ that the actions are in accordance with intention. Hence, if we take the أَسْبَابُ الْوُرُودِ, the reasons for why the Messenger of Allah said this, then we can say that إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ is specific to those people who then hijra from Medina to Mecca, from Mecca to Medina, and does not include people today. However, this is a fallacy and is rejected outright. In the same way, we reject this interpretation of the hadith من سنة في الإسلام سنة حسنة إلى آخر الحديث. With regard to the second rebuttal that we only accept an innovation in the religion which has a asl, a root in the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we say that this is what we are forwarding as well. Any practice that is practiced by anyone into the religion and is not in contradiction to the Quran, it is not in contradiction to the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is accepted. Otherwise, it is rejected. If it is a bid'ah munkara, a rejected bid'ah or bid'ah sayyi'ah, an evil innovation. Hence, al-bid'ah al-hasana, a good innovation, is proven from the hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Also, what should be taken into account is the qawl of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu in Sahih al-Bukhari, when he radiallahu anhu said, نعمة البدعة هذه. And in another narration, نعم البدعة هذه. What a beautiful innovation. They replied by saying that this innovation was specific to the Taraweeh, that the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم performed the Taraweeh for a certain amount of days. And when he صلى الله عليه وسلم performed the Taraweeh for a certain amount of days, then he abandoned it on the fourth day. Hence, he feared that the Taraweeh may become farz upon his ummah. So he stopped the jama'ah of Taraweeh, and Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu revived this practice. Hence, there is a root in the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to practice this practice. However, this is not the understanding which the Sahaba radiallahu anhu has, because in a hadith narrated regarding the duha prayer, the dawn prayer, after the dawn, when we pray the two cycles, the two units of duha, some of the tabi'een begun the practice of praying the duha prayer in jama'ah, in a group. And Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu was asked, what do you say about this practice? And he said, bid'ah. He just said, bid'ah. It is an innovation. However, in Fath al-Bari, Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani radiallahu anhu narrates that Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu said that next, regarding the duha in jama'ah, because it was not done by the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ni'ma til bid'atu hadihi. This has been narrated in the Musannaf of Ibn Abi Shayba radiallahu anhu. Hence, the understanding of Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu regarding the qawl of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu was not the same as the way people understand it to be today. Now, the same people do not fear Allah by going ahead and saying that Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, by making the people pray 20 units of a Taraweeh, performed an innovation. Certain people state this in their books. And they say Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu performed an innovation against the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. However, one needs to understand as to what the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith narrated by Imam al-Tirmidhi in his sunan, Imam Ahmad in his musnad, and Imam al-Nasa'i in his sunan, on the authority of Irbab ibn Thariya radiallahu anhu, regarding the wa'ad, the preaching of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Sahaba wept, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ يَعِيشُ بَعْدِ سَيَرَى فِتَنًا كَثِيرًا Whoever lives after me, or in another generation, اِخْتِلَافَاتٍ كَثِيرًا Whoever lives after me will see much difference. And they said, what shall we do, Ya Rasulullah? And he صلى الله عليه وسلم said, عَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّةِ Follow my sunnah. وَسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاءِ الرَّاشِدِينَ And sunnah of the rightly guided caliph, المهديين. The rightly guided caliph. عضوها بالنواجذ. Hold on to the sunnah with your whole teeth. Hence, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also said in a hadith in the sunnah of Imam al-Tirmidhi, narrated in the chapter of Manaqib, اقتدوا بعد أبا بكر وعمر فرع التمري أبو بكر وعمر and سيدنا عمر رضي الله عنه. Hence, the practice of سيدنا عمر رضي الله عنه وقتي وقعال تراويح is from the bid'ah hasana, because this was called a bid'ah hasana by him radiallahu anhu when he said ni'matil bid'atu hadhihi. Certain people go further by saying that if the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stayed quiet on an issue, he did not mention that issue to be haram, and he did not mention that issue to be halal, then that issue, practicing that practice, is also haram. We say no, because the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith narrated by Baghdad in his Musnad and others in their collection, and Imam Abu Dawud in his Sunan and Imam Hakim in his Mustadra, مَنْ سَكَتَ عَنْهُ عَفْوًا That which he stayed quiet on me, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is forgiven, عَفْوًا So, الْأَسْلُ فِي الْأَشْيَاءِ الْإِبَاحَةِ The originality of things is ibaha, is legality. If the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has not said something is haram, then that thing is legal and valid in the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hence, my dear brothers, when we are presented with the hadith of kullu bid'atin dalala wa kullu dalalatin fil nar, we should take all these ahadith into mind and present them to the brothers who bring these ahadith forward in order to make them understand as to how bid'ah should be understood. A good has gone on longer regarding this issue, but I think in hope of itala, in expatiating the topic, I'll stop here. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وأتوب إليه.
We're opening for question and answers now. You know this distinction between a good bid'ah and a bad bid'ah, which you just explained now. You know, Ibn Taymiyyah, who's the so-called Imam of the Wahhabis, his student Ibn Kathir, very famous, wrote the commentary on the Quran and everything like that. In his commentary, he explains the distinction between like two types of bid'ah, but he doesn't use the same one as you. Why is that? Can you explain how it is?
There's something called istilahat, and there's a famous saying of the scholars, there is no argument in istilahat in technical terms. So the Shafi'iyah may call something bid'ah hasana, and he may say bid'ah manduba, for instance. This is a jargon, and the jargon may differ from madhab to madhab. Ibn Kathir was a Shafi'i, and in the Shafi'i madhab there's ittifaq on the taqseem of bid'ah, because Imam al-Shafi'i radiallahu anhu divided bid'ah into two types. This has been reported by Imam Bayhaqi in the Manaqib of Imam al-Shafi'i and in the Hilyatul Awliya, that Imam al-Shafi'i divided bid'ah into bid'ah hasana and bid'ah sayyi'ah. The later mutaakhirin, they divided bid'ah into five types, like Izz ibn Abdul Salam, Imam Nawawi, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, Imam al-Suyuti, and Ibn Abidin al-Nishashiya, Ibn Arabi al-Maliki, in Aritat al-Ahradi, the commentary on Sunan al-Tirmidhi, Imam al-Zurqani, in his commentary on the Muwatta of Imam Malik, Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali, these scholars and many others, Imam al-Surtushi in his book al-Bid'ah wal-Huwadith on page 158, he brings the category of bid'ah hasana and bid'ah sayyi'ah. However, if they use a different term for the bid'ah, there's no difference on what it actually is. There's agreement on what the bid'ah actually is. Is any other question?
Yeah, I was approached by an individual and he said to me that I shouldn't be using fasting, it's haram. And the Jews and the Christians used to have fasting. So it's an innovation for the deen.
Firstly, with regards to what we just mentioned, if anything new is incorporated into the deen, a lot of deen, we have to weigh it on the scale of قَالَ اللَّهُ وَقَالَ رَسُولُهُ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. Has Allah made that thing haram? Has the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم made that thing haram? If not, then that thing is valid. However, there is a narration regarding Sayyiduna Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu reported in the Hilyatul Awliya and other books regarding Sayyiduna Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu carrying a string with 1,000 knots, and he would count his tasbih on the string of 1,000 knots. There is also a Sahih Hadith narrated in the Muslim of Imam Ahmad radiallahu anhu that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam entered upon one of his wives and she was counting date stones, thousands of date stones, and he taught her what to read upon the stones. So hence, the string and the stones are both from the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Big scholars, major scholars have been known to carry the tasbih, like Imam Junaid, Ibn Hajar, and others. So we do not reject this practice as bid'ah sayyi'ah, rather it's bid'ah hasana. Any other questions?
Well, I want to ask the question, why do people do this, you know, especially in this masjid, what they do, I see a lot of people, when they ask them to pray, when they do the dua or something, they do this. What?
This practice of using the thumb and rubbing on the iron when you hear the name of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has been narrated in a hadith, from hadith. The hadith is in the Musnad al-Firdaus of Imam al-Daylami. In his Musnad, he narrates that Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, in the name of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was mentioned in the Adhan. He kissed his thumb and placed it on his eyes like this. When the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam seen him do this, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam informed him that by practicing this, his eyesight will not fail. Those who practice this practice that hadith. This hadith has also been mentioned by Imam al-Sakhawi in his Al-Maqasid al-Hasana. It's also been mentioned by Imam al-Tahtawi in his commentary on Raq al-Falah in the Hanafi Madhhab, because certain Diyawandis also reject this practice. And it has also been mentioned by Imam Ibn Abidin in his Hashiya as a mustahab, a recommended act to do whenever you hear the name of the Prophet ﷺ in the Adhan. Those who reject this practice because they say that the hadith that has been narrated regarding this is a weak hadith. However, the ulama have ittifaq, the Ahlul Hadith, the people of hadith and knowledge, they have ittifaq that weak hadith that do not have a liar or a forger, a person who forges a hadith, if they mention a practice in a hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then that practice is a valid practice and it can be acted upon for fadailul a'mal, meaning virtuous acts, and this is also from the virtuous act. Hence, Imam Nawawi, for instance, mentions this qaida in the beginning of his Arba'een. He mentions this in the beginning of his Adhkar. Ibn Kathir mentions it in his book Al-Usul Al-Hadith. And Imam Al-Dahdi mentions it in Al-Muqida. And other scholars mention it. Imam Sayyuti mentions it in his Tadreen. Imam Sakhawi mentions it in his Fathul Mubeen. And other scholars mention this qaida that we hadith are allowed for fadail and a'mal, allowed as long as they do not have one muttaham bil kizb, someone who has been accused of lying or a dajjal, an outright forger.
Question. You know, some people saying that the Maliki Imams, the Mutaqaddimin, they don't have a Aqsam al-Bid'ah.
The Malikiya do have Aqsam al-Bid'ah in their book. If you check the commentary of Imam al-Zurqani on the Mu'atta of Imam Malik, you will find the definition, the dividing of Bid'ah into good type and bad type, into five types in fact. If you check the book of Imam al-Turtushi, al-Hawadith wal-Bid'ah, page 158, you will find the taqseem of al-Bid'ah. If you check Al-Tat al-Aqradi of Imam Ibn Arabi al-Maliki, you'll find the Taqseem al-Bid'ah. The person who opposed the Taqseem al-Bid'ah from the Maliki Madhab was Imam al-Shatibi radiallahu anhu in his book Al-Istiqam. He rejects the practice of good Bid'ah. In the Quran we have Bid'ah mentioned four times in the Quran, twice. Regarding the sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, بَدِيعُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, the originator of the heavens and the earth. This is mentioned by Allah in Surah Al-Baqarah and Surah Al-An'am. Another time, we have mentioned Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Surah Al-Ahqaf, Al-Ahqaf, plural of Haf, meaning the winding track in the desert. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is told to say, قُلْ مَا كُنْتُ بِدْعًا مِنَ الرُّسُلِ, say, I am not something new from the messengers. However, these three meanings, the term bid'ah is not technical. However, in Surah Al-Hadid, we find the technical term of bid'ah used regarding the monks. Regarding the monks, when they innovated the practice of monasticism. And this has been mentioned in the Quran in Surah Al-Hadid towards the end, When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that they innovated the practice of monasticism and they did not stick to it, Imam al-Shatibi says from this that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then the meme of those people rejected the practice of them instituting the practice of monasticism. However, if taken into account properly the verse of the Quran, one will understand from this verse that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not reject the actual practice of monasticism. However, he rejected those who did not practice what they innovated into the religion properly. This is further elucidated by Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu in the Sunan of Imam al-Nasa'i, where he mentioned that the practice, a long hadith which I would have read out tonight regarding the practice of monasticism, and for those who want to check it, check it in the Sunan of Imam al-Nasa'i on the authority of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu for further elucidation. However, another point to be mentioned is that Imam al-Shafi'i says that what also should be taken into account that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the practice of monasticism mansukh in our religion, abrogated in our religion. However, what is to be noted here is that the practice of monasticism is not abrogated fully in our religion. The only part of monasticism or zuhud in our religion that has been abrogated fully is the practice of not of abstinence from getting married. Apart from this one practice, the rest of monasticism is a praiseworthy act if someone goes into caves and takes up the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to read Quran. This is praiseworthy as mentioned in the hadith in Sahih Muslim regarding a man who goes to the peaks of mountains and saves people from his fitna and himself from the fitna of the age.
They say that this ayah indicates that you can only ask help from Allah the word iyyah that you use, and only ask guidance from Allah. So when they say you go to the bar of the ayah and ask for their dua, this is
even though this is related to another topic, not to the topic of bid'ah, even though they may bring this into bid'ah, meaning the practice of tawassul being an innovative practice, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. We only worship you and we only ask you for help. However, in the Quran, if you check, you will never find where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders us Muslims to worship anyone else apart from him. Allah does not say worship such and such idol and such person, because that would lead to shirk. However, we do find where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ. Ask help from sabr, patience and salah. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ, we only worship you and we only ask you for help, Allah orders us in another part of the Quran in Surah Al-Baqarah, وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ. Ask help from الصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ. So this shows that what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-Fatiha is not what is taken and understood by those who forbid the wasul. Rather, what this means as the understanding of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah is that the sabr and the salah are two creations of Allah. The sabr is a creation of Allah, and we ask a sabr for help, because Allah has ordered us to ask a sabr for help. وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ. And the salah is also a creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we ask the salah for help. But this does not mean that we have associated with a partner with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. حَلَفَ لِلَّهِ. Of course not. Because we believe that Allah has placed in the sabr and the salah such attributes that help the mu'mineen, hence he has told them, وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ. Hence, the verse, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ should be taken alongside with وَاسْتَعِينُ بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ. Hence, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allowed Muslims to ask from other than Allah for help in sabr and salah, we ask where does this restriction come from, not allowing Muslims to ask the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for help and the awliya for help. Where does this restriction come from? With the same i'tiqad, same belief we have regarding isti'ana with as-sabr and salah, we hold the same i'tiqad with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Is there any what's the importance of 786? Is there any importance of these numbers?
786 has a historical meaning. In the Arabic language, we have a knowledge called ilm al-abjad. Ilm al-abjad is when each letter of the alphabet is given a numerical value. What happened in the subcontinent is that during the British Empire, when the Hindus were employed in the mail service and the British would hire kuffar, the Muslims would write letters to each other writing Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim on the letter. When this letter would go through the service, the royal mail at that time, the employees of the mail system would see the Bismillah written on the letter and they would place the letter on the floor and place their foot on the letter in order to disrespect the Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. When the ulama of those regions found this practice prevalent amongst the kuffar, the employees of the mail system, they took the ilm al-abjad, the knowledge of the abjad, the numerical system in Arabic language, and valued the Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim to mean 786. 786, if you take the letters of Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, place them in numerical value, they would add up to 786. When they done this, they would write on the letters 786. What this would do in effect is when the letter would reach the recipient, he would open the letter and see 786 written on the letter. This would remind him to say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And when the letter would be placed under the foot of the employees, this would not be any type of disrespect to the actual Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, because what he's actually stepping on is just some number, 786. Hence that was the origin of the 786. Also to be noted is Imam Baydawi in Tafsir mentioned a hadith, a weak hadith nevertheless, regarding the Jews when they came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they mentioned the Alif Lameen. They asked him regarding the Alif Lameen, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam deduced from the Alif Lameen a numerical value, the Jews deduced from the Alif Lameen a numerical value. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not stop them from doing so. Rather, he laughed. He laughed when they deduced the numerical value. So many of the scholars allowed this practice to be prevalent where non-Muslims disrespect the actual Bismillah and they allowed the writing of the 786. However, it became so widespread amongst the Muslims of the subcontinent that they stuck to the practice and did not leave it. However, I think it's a good practice when it comes to wedding cards if they write 786 to remind the people of Bismillah, because people usually disrespect the actual Bismillah itself.
Just wondering about the khatams when a person passes away. They say that you've got to do khatam the fourth day, on the 14th day or the 35th day or whatever. What is the relevance in that? What is the actual, what should you actually be doing?
Okay.
Regarding the khatam.
With regards to what they term khatam, first we have to understand what are we actually doing when we do any type of good deed and we do a du'a over that good deed, what are we actually intending? What Some Muslims in hell is that a reward of reciting Quran or reciting a hadith or any type of good deed, reciting salawat upon the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We send these rewards, the reward of this, to the dead. And they benefit from this reward. Now, this practice has been mentioned by the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a hadith in the Sahih of Imam al-Bukhari, where a companion wanted to benefit a person of his family who had passed away, and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him to give away a garden of fruit. A garden of fruit. So he donated this garden of fruit in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the reward was given to his relative who had passed away. In another hadith, in Sahih Muslim, where the mother of Da'ad radiallahu anhu passed away, he radiallahu anhu opened a well, and he was told by the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to open a well and write, هَذَا بِئْرُ أُمِّ دَعَدْ. This is the well of the mother of Da'ad. And whosoever drank from the well, he would receive the reward of the mother of Sa'ad radiallahu anhu would receive the reward even though she was dead. This is the actual concept of khatam, that when someone passes away, we do some type of good deed to reward the person who's passed away. We can give food to someone, which is the most prevalent practice. We can recite Quran, we can recite Nawaf, we can pray Nawaf, and we can do other good deeds. We can do a Hajj, we can do Umrah and other good deeds on the behalf of the person who is passed away. Specifying a day is not necessary. Specifying a day is not necessary. You can do this any time, even when the person is alive. For instance, in one hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam narrated in the Sahih of Imam Muslim, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam brought a black sheep and he sacrificed that sheep and he said, this reward is for the Imam of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, those who have passed away, those who are alive, and those who will come as well. So the reward of that slaughter went to all of us. In another hadith, on a man was going to the Hajj and he met Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, narrated in the book of Al-Nasa'i, presumably, in one of the four books. And he met Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu and he said to him, perform two raka'at of my jihad. So he received the reward of them two units. Specifying the day is not necessary. What makes this practice seem bad in the eyes of others is that the people who practice these practices, they do not pray 5 times a day, or they do not do their tarawih, they do not know how to read Quran properly, many of them. Hence, the practice itself seems like an innovation. Rather, what should not be condemned is not the practice itself. Rather, what should be condemned is the ignorance of those who do it. That they should do their tarawih, they should pray their 5 days in prayer. They should learn their deeds. But this does not make the practice haram. For instance, when people do Eid here today, many of them play loud music and ride on the road, as we see. This does not make Eid haram. This makes the practice of what them people are doing haram. Hence, rather than condemning the actual concept of what they call khatam or biyawi or these types of practices, and rather than attacking the actual concept, what should be attacked is the ignorance of those who do it. And we should try to, inshallah, revise the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by practicing the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and teaching people their deeds, how to pray their prayers, and then practice these practices.
You know, like, it's a believer to like, sometimes, like, if they're just friends, just like with non-believers, and if the non-believers are like, really cross, even if they call themselves the Muslims, and they'll let them still cross.
They're non-believers.
They could easily believe it, just as friends, but like, one person out of all the group actually used the Salah, since they passed, but we are the rest of them, they interact with all the Islam. Could just by like turning up, could the believer get enough to raise up?
He can.
And in fact, you shouldn't stay in the country, you should avoid the country. Unless you tell them that you should pray, and if they listen, then you should stay with them. And if they don't listen, then you shouldn't stay with them. Because if you tell someone to pray, and they say you're not going to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you should avoid their company and shun their company. Because the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, bad company is like a blacksmith. The blacksmith charges those who catch the smell from him. And a good company is like an oil merchant, a person who sells perfume. Even if he doesn't give you perfume, you still have some of the fragrance from that perfume and oil which he sells. Hence the same is with deen. You should love people for the sake of Allah and His Prophet, and you should hate people for the sake of Allah. With non-Muslims, you should be straight up and give them da'wah to Islam and tell them to become Muslim. If they reject Allah and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you should not stay in their company, because they have rejected Allah and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What could be worse than that? In reality it's common sense, but if people become blinded by friendship, friendship is blinding. So because of that, you should avoid their company.
That there's certain like medical innovations which make us question, which some people find may question their belief. However, they help us with like many medical problems. So can we study these sort of things?
Yes. In the religion, we have something called jurisprudence, fiqh, where we study whether certain things are halal or haram, and medicine would fall into this, like transplant or giving blood donation. The scholars have written on these issues. Some have allowed it, some have disallowed it, whatever reason they may have. But Islam doesn't hinder this progress. Islam doesn't hinder medical progress. In fact, if anyone hinders it, it's people who have not understanding of kullu bid'atin wa dalala. Them narrow-minded, straight-jacketed people would hinder the progress of Islam in today's age more than anyone. However, the scholars, the fuqaha, they have written books on these issues.
So are you saying that it's permissible for an animal to have an animal organ, for example, of a pig or something, and a human?
No, I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is that the scholars will look at each medical progress of itself. For instance, what you just mentioned would not be allowed. So because of that, they will look at each actual mas'ala issue of itself, whether it's halal or haram. But what this has to do with bid'ah is that certain people who are narrow-minded, they may not allow any type of progress in medicine because they say it's all bid'ah. Even though I've never met anyone so stupid. But you may find them.
Any more questions?
No. There's one question.
Regarding ta'weez. You know ta'weez, what remember a general word is regards to a ta'weez and a ruqyah. A ruqyah is when you recite something and blow it on someone, and a ta'weez is when you hang something off the neck. General rule, whatever hadith we find denouncing ta'weez, you know that those ahadith are denouncing the hadith, the ta'weez, with shirk and bid'ah in there. There's a sahih hadith in the Sunnah of Imam al-Tirmidhi regarding Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-Aas radiallahu anhu, that he made his children wear the ta'weez around their neck, where they hold the Quran around their neck. The scholars adduce from that any type of ta'weez which has Quran or anything from the Sunnah of the Prophet is a valid practice, and anything that has other than that is invalid. Also, the verses in the Quran regarding the shifa, they come around six times, once in Surah Al-Nahl, regarding the Quran in the shifa, and because of that, they are validated the practice of the ta'weez.
I've heard that some people have said that there's seven heavens, and I've heard the story of the saying that Milad Shri, that there's eight heavens for which we will get into, like if they do.
Take the difference between al-sab'u al-samawat and al-jannah. Al-sab'u al-samawat, the seven heavens, are the layers of sky. So the first layer of heaven is not what we see above the stars.
The second one is above that, the third one, fourth, fifth, sixth, and seventh. And above that is the figure of Al-Muzahar, the lote tree. And then above the lote tree is the arsh. Now, the Jannah is something else. The Jannah is a separate creation. Paradise is different from heaven. The seven heavens are the level of sky. And the paradise is something else. You're referring to the Mi'raj, when the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ascended up, he went to the seven heavens. Not, he went to the paradise as well, but he ascended the seven heavens. So there's a difference between the seven heavens and the seven jannas.
So the seven jannas and the seven heavens?
Yeah. The jannah is a creation within the heavens.
So you don't go to the heavens, you go to the jannah.
Yeah, but the jannah is in the seven heavens. All creation is under the throne.
What about those amulets that are numerical and no Quran ayat or anything that they're written?
Again, that would fall under the rubric of ilm al-arjad.
But where is that Islamically proven?
Islamically proven is proven from the hadith in the tafsir of Imam Baydawi, where the Prophet writes, not reject the practice, and secondly, under the same rubric. In fact, this ilm is called ilm al-waqf. And this is mentioned in al-Ibraq, Imam al-Ghazali in his book, and he deals with it in the Ihya al-Muddin. You can check that yourself. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Allahumma sallim wa sallim wa barik ala Sayyidina Muhammad. كلما ذكرك الذاكرون وغفل عن ذكرك الغافلون اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى اله واصحابه اجمعين رحمتك يا ارحم الراحمين.
Just a continuation from where we left off from a few days ago regarding bid'ah and some points of contention which were brought up from certain quarters regarding al-bid'ah. One point which was mentioned, for example, is a point mentioned in an English translation of Barbahari's creed by a certain vulgar anthropomorphist local innovator whom I think we should not even mention his name to give him more publicity than he deserves. He mentioned a narration narrated in the Sunan of Imam ad-Darimi, not providing any reference, so I checked the original Sunan of Imam ad-Darimi, volume 1. The offset print published in Ash-Sham on page 68 in the Muqaddimah of the Sunan, a hadith which begins with Akhbarana al-Hakim ibn al-Mubarak أخبرنا عمر بن يحيى قال سمعت أبي يحدث عن أبيه. After providing the chain of narration, he says قال كنا نجلس على باب عبد الله بن مسعود, that we would sit at the door of عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه قبل صلاة الغداة, prior to the Fajr prayer. الغداة referring to the morning prayer. فإذا خرج, and he left his house, مشينا معه, we walked with him, إلى المسجد, to the mosque, فجاءنا أبو موسى الأشعري رضي الله عنه, and came to us أبو موسى الأشعري, فقال أخرج إليكم أبو عبد الرحمن بعد, has come to you أبو عبد الرحمن afterwards, قلنا, we said لا, فجلس معنا, so he sat with us, حتى خرج, until أبو عبد الرحمن, meaning عبد الله بن مسعود, came out, فلما خرج قمنا إليه جميعا, when he came out, we stood for him, all of us. This can also be used as a دليل if the hadith was authentic, for standing up for scholars and for ulama and people of learning. فقال له أبو موسى, so Abu Musa said to him, Ya Aba Abdul Rahman, O father of Abdul Rahman, إِنِّي رَأَيْتُ فِي الْمَسْجِدِ آنِفًا أَمْرًا. Recently I have seen something in the mosque, أَنْكَرْتُهُ, I rejected it, وَلَمْ أَرَى, وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ إِلَّا خَيْرًا, I did not see except good, and all praises to Allah. قَالَ فَمَا هُوَ, so Abu عبد الرحمن, meaning Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, رضي الله عنه, asked him, what is that? فقال إن عشت فستراه, if you lived you will see that, meaning that matter. قال رأيت في المسجد قوما حلقا جلوسا, I seen in the mosque a people sitting in circles, ينتظرون الصلاة, they are waiting for the prayer, في كل حلقة رجل, and in every circle there is a man, وفي أيديهم حصى, and in their hands they have stones, فيقول كبر مئة, and he says to them, do تكبير 100 times, فيكبرون مئة, and they do تكبير 100 times, فيقول هللوا مئة, and he says to them, do تهليل is to say لا إله إلا الله, فيهللون مئة, and they do the تهليل 100 times, ويقول سبحوا, and he says read the تسبيح, يعني سبحان الله, مئة, فيسبحون مئة, and they make the تسبيح 100 times. قال فماذا قلت لهم, so Abdullah ibn Mas'ud questioned him, what do you say to them? قال ما قلت لهم شيئا. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiyallahu anhu said, I did not say anything to them. انتظار رأيك أو انتظار أمرك, waiting for your opinion and waiting for your order. قال, so Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, أفلا أمرتهم أن يعدوا سيئاتهم, it would have been better if you had ordered them to count their bad deeds. وَضَمِنْتَ لَهُمْ أَلَّا يَضِيعَ مِنْ حَسَنَاتِهِمْ, وَضَمِنْتَ لَهُمْ أَلَّا يُضَيِّعَ مِنْ حَسَنَاتِهِمْ, and had guaranteed them not to waste their bad deeds, i.e. by doing the former action. ثُمَّ مَضَى, then he went, وَمَضَيْنَ مَعَهُ, and we went with him, حَتَّى أَتَى حَلَقَةً مِنْ تِلْكَ الْحَلَقِ, until he came to the circle from them circles, فَوَقَفَ عَلَيْهِمْ, and he stood amongst them, فَقَالَ مَا هَذَا الَّذِي أَرَاكُمْ تَصْنَعُونَ, what is this I see you people performing? قَالُوا, they said, يَا أَبَا عَبْدِ اللَّهِ حُسَى, نعد به التكبير والتهليل والتسبيح, that we count with them the تكبير, the تهليل, and the تسبيح. So Abu عبد الرحمن, سيدنا أبو عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنهم, said to them, فعدوا سيئاتكم فأنا ضامن ألا يضيع من حسناتكم شيئا, that count your bad deeds and I guarantee you that you will not waste from your good deeds anything, i.e. by counting from your bad deeds. وَيْحَكُمْ يَا أُمَّةَ مُحَمَّدٍ, woe to you, O nation of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, مَا أَسْرَعُ حَلَكْتَكُمْ هَؤُلَاءِ صَحَابَةُ نَبِيِّكُمْ, how quickly you have destroyed yourselves. Here are the companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, mutawafirun, spread out amongst you. وَهَذِهِ ثِيَابُهُ لَمْ تَبُلْ لَمْ تَبَلْ وَآنِيَتُهُ لَمْ تَقْصُرْ, and here is his thiyab, his garment, that has not become worn away, and his pot that has not been broken. والذي نفسي بيده بيده by the one whom my soul is in his hand, in his hand. أنكم لعلى ملة هي أهدى من ملة ملة سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. Are you upon a thing which is more guiding than the millah, the way of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم؟ أو مفتتح باب ضلال مفتتح باب ضلالة. قالوا والله يا أبا عبد الرحمن ما أردنا إلا الخير. That either that or you are opening the door of misguidance. They said, by Allah, O Abu Abd al-Rahman, ما أردنا إلا الخير. We did not intend except good. قال وكم من مريد للخير لن يصيبه. That how many people intend good except that they do not attain good. أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, that verily the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, حدثنا أن قوما, that verily a قوم, a people, يقرؤون القرآن, they will read the Quran, لا يجاوز تراقيهم, it will not pass down their throats. وأيما الله ما أدري, and verily by Allah I do not know, لعل أكثرهم منكم, that the vast majority of them are from you. ثم تولى عنهم, and then he turned away from them. فقال عمر بن سلمة, and عمر بن سلمة said, رأينا عامة أولئك الحلق يطاعموننا يوم النهروان مع الخوارج. And we seen the vast majority of them circles fighting against us on the day of النهروان with the خوارج. So people use this hadith to say that there is no bid'ah hasana in the sharia of Sayyiduna Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. However, certain points need to be pointed out regarding this hadith. Firstly, the narrator from the sheikh from whom Ad-Darimi has taken the hadith from, Al-Hakam ibn al-Mubarak, has been declared weak by Yahya ibn Ma'in and other scholars, as pointed out by Imam al-Zahabi in Mizan al-I'tidal and his book Al-Mughni fi al-Du'afa wal-Matruqeen. And hence the Ahl-Sunnati wal-Jama'a do not take this one khabar from the Sahabi radiallahu anhu, a weak narration that states something contrary to other ahadith that have been widespread in the Sahihain, in the Sahih of Imam Muslim, reported in the Sahih of Imam al-Bukhari and the Sahih of Imam Muslim, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam praised dhikr circles. A second point regarding this hadith that must be pointed out is that the inkar, the rejection of Sayyiduna Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, was not based upon the actual action of those people. Rather, it was based upon the isolationist policy of those people which they had undertaken by practicing such practices within the presence of the companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And this can be seen throughout the hadith. For instance, the isolationist attitude of those people by staying away from the circle of the companions and conducting their own circles, not in the presence of the companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Another point is that towards the end of the hadith, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu states that he sees the signs of the khawarij in these people. Hence his reason for saying to these people that your conduct is not in accordance with the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was based upon them having the hallmarks of the Khawarijis, condemnation of their practice was based upon the fact that these people carried the hallmarks of the Khawarij. Hence, the practice of zikr circles and bid'ah hasana cannot be condemned by this singular weak narration narrated in the collection of Ad-Darimi. Slightly moving on, another point of contention that was mentioned by the circles of innovators who are against the agreement of the scholars, the ittifaq, I would say rather, of scholars regarding bid'ah hasana, the good bid'ah which we dealt with in the prior lecture, is that they state that certain practices that have been conducted by the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah are not valid. One certain practice is carrying the subha or al-misbaha, the tasbih which people carry and count their tasbih and tahleel and takbir of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This hadith has been narrated, the following hadith has been narrated in the Hilyatul Awliya wa Tabaqat al-Asfiya, a written work of Al-Imam Al-Hafidh Abu Na'im, who died in the year 430. He mentions in the biography of Sayyiduna Abu Hurairah radiyallahu anhu, حدثنا أحمد بن جعفر بن حمدان حدثنا عبد الله بن أحمد بن حنبل حدثنا الحسن بن الصباح حدثنا زيد بن الحباب عن عبد الواحد بن موسى قال أخبرني نعيم بن المحرر عن أبي هريرة عن جده أبي هريرة from the grandson of سيدنا أبو هريرة رضي الله عنه أنه كان that سيدنا أبو هريرة رضي الله عنه would carry with him كان له خيط فيه ألف عقدة فيه ألف that he had a string that had 1,000 knots فلا ينام حتى يسبح به. And he would not sleep until he had counted the full 1,000 knots with a tasbih of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hence, the asl of al-tasbih and subha is taken from the hadith of Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu reported in the Hilyatul Awliya. However, the asl is also reported in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam walked into the chamber of one of his wives, Safiya radiallahu anha, and seen her with date stones counting the tasbih of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he taught her a specific tasbih. Hence this shows the asl of this subha has an asl in the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Another point which was mentioned by those people who carry contention was regarding the tasbih, regarding the At-Tarawih prayer and its rak'at, its number of cycles.